Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, and a wonderful evening, here's Herbie J Pilato.
Yay!
Thank you very much, Diane.
Hi, everybody. How's everybody doing?
Good.
So excited, you know, with this happening every week here in Burbank. It's a very, very unique situation. As the founder of the Classic TV Preservation Society, I dedicate my life to the positive influence of classic television. And I've done it really in general for 20 years, but in the last few years I formed the Classic TV Preservation Society, which is a nonprofit organization that is dedicated to the positive influence. And I started with seminars in schools and colleges and community centers back in Rochester, New York, my hometown, and then I just expanded it around the country. So if you're here visiting, or if you see this all over the world, just email me or Facebook me at herbiejpilato.blogspot.com. Communicate to me through that, and I will come to your school and your college and your community center, your senior center, your business facility, wherever. I could talk about Classic TV and its positive influence. Every week here in Burbank at the Burbank Barnes and Noble, we have various celebrities from Classic TV shows like Laverne and Shirley and Land of the Lost, Kathy Coleman, we had a couple weeks ago. In the future, in episodes, this is really one of our episodes, we have Don Wells from Gilligan's Island, Kathy Garver from Family Affair, Ron Dante, the Archies, will be singing Sugar Sugar, his famous pop song, in a couple weeks. But tonight we have a very, very special guest. And usually, sometimes, you know, we have two or three guests. Tonight we just have one, because he's really a unique individual, and I'm gonna sit down and I will introduce him in a second. Ladies and gentlemen, Anson Williams.
Cold ears.
Warm heart?
Warm heart. Oh my gosh. First time I had a pillow. Pillow on a chair, it's nice.
There you go.
Hello.
How are you, Anson?
I'm good.
You know, the first thing that came to my mind when I thought of having you on the show was that years ago, when you guys were doing Happy Days, you were all on the Merv Griffin show. It was like, I think, probably the peak season.
Yep. It was Mike Douglas' show.
No, I saw you on Merv, too.
Oh, I was on Merv a lot by myself.
But the group was all on Mike Douglas?
Yep. That was the one.
Okay, well, maybe you didn't do Merv together? Are you sure?
I'm sure.
Okay.
I had a fight for that show.
Okay. Well, the point is, you guys all had such a camaraderie.
Yes, we did.
You know, and you really liked each other off screen.
Yes,
we
did.
And it came right through.
Yes.
And that just stuck in my head, you know, and it just seemed to, that happens a lot on hit TV shows. And I think that contributes to a hit or a TV show. Would you agree with that? I mean, it's important to like each other behind the scenes. That's what I'm trying to say.
You know, Happy Days, for some reason, there was an it factor, because the show became much more than the page, the written page. And, I don't know, it was the brilliance of Gary Marshall and, you know, and his choice for casting. But then there was another level that happened. I don't know. I really haven't seen it since. The camaraderie, the connection we had as a cast is incredible. But then you go to Lucy, right? I Love Lucy, mm-hmm. which, you know, no, you know, what was it? Vivian Vance and Bill Frawley, they hated each other.
It's true.
They never talked to each other. Yet there was some incredible chemistry on air. You know, in terms of. So I don't know. I don't know if that's the cause of hit show or not. I think what the cause of hit show is that it factor when the cameras roll. I can't help but think that maybe the longevity of Happy Days was because of the friendship too, because we went on for 10 and a half years.
Mm-hmm.
I Love Lucy was fine. Seriously, but it does help a lot in a show to have a friendship. Definitely helps, I think, in any profession.
Well, let's go back to the pilot, on Love American Style. It was like a 12-minute segment.
It was a 30-minute segment.
On Love American Style?
Yeah, it was the first pilot. There were two pilots for Happy Days.
Oh.
Originally, the pilot starred Ron Howard, and I was in it, and Marion was in it, but a different actress played Joni, a different actor played Mr. C. Well, it wasn't Mr. C, it was Mr. Cunningham.
Right.
And that was Harold Gould.
Right.
And
And that was the Love American Style.
That was, well, what happened, they played it off Love American Style. It was a separate pilot.
Oh.
And my agents are telling me, oh my God, this is great, it's a definite sell. And basically, up to then, I was playing the concerned boyfriend parts, where there'd be five pages, a big scene, and I'd have five lines. So I became the best reactor on television. Everyone's talking, I'm going. Whatever, you know, and finally, and I'm waiting for my line. I understand. And then we go, and that was my life, but it paid the rent, right? So I get this, audition, happy day, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, I go there, I get it. But the first pilot, if you ever saw it on Love American Style, it was more like Summer 42. Yeah. It was kinder. It was, Love in the, it was like the first
Love
television
and the happy set. Days, yeah.
In the television. It was very calm and very nice and very sweet. And oh my God, and it didn't sell. And and I'm thinking, oh my, there we go. You know, there we go. Everyone says it's not going to sell. But that's, you know, my book, there was a story on there about better ways to get there. So I'm thinking, oh, it's going to, oh, and it doesn't sell. But however, in that pilot, there was no Ralph, there was no Potsy, there was no Aaron Moran, there was no Tom Bosley. So a year later, American Graffiti comes out, which I auditioned for, same part as Ron. He was better, he got it. And Grease was out on Broadway, you know, huge hit. So all of a sudden there was this 50s phenomena. And ABC, the intelligent folks they are, went, didn't we have a pilot about the 50s a year ago? Mm-hmm. So I was doing Lisa Bright and Dark in San Francisco with Kay Lenz. And I was paying her boyfriend. You know, it was like a 142 page script, I had 10 lines. But it was a daily wage. So anyway, I get this call from my agent while I'm up there. Hey, they're going to do another pilot for Happy Days. I go, fantastic. Oh, when do we start? He goes, well, they kind of want to screen test you this time. I go, what are you talking about? They said, well, they think you and Ron might be too old. So, I go, really? Yeah, really. So there we are. They're going to do another pilot for Happy Days. Anyway, I hadn't seen Ron for a long time. I go down there, and there, you know, it was a wardrobe fitting. And there was Ron. We're getting this wardrobe fitting. And the next day, they were screen testing. And Ron tells me, Anson, you know, I've been through this a few times. I go, yeah, I figured you did, but, you know, a lot more than me. He goes, listen. He said, they don't give you a lot of time. You know, they're 20 minutes tops. He goes, let's find out where we're shooting the screen test, and then let's rehearse ourselves. Basically, Ron directing me, and he says, I got a hunch. If we like come off like it's just happening at the moment, they'll spend more time with us. I go, good idea. So we find the stage. We know where others. We go on there. They're finishing painting the set, and they let us like rehearse. So for a couple hours, Ron and I like came up with all these bits. So we're first up in the morning. Gary Marshall's directing. It's supposed to be 20 minutes, right? 2 hours later, because he got involved with us, because we had all these spontaneous creative ideas, P.S. we got the parts again. Now Don Most, who auditioned for Potsy, most people don't know this, was so brilliant, they created the part of Ralph for him. That wasn't even in the script originally. And then Henry Winkler for Fonzie, that was like a very minimal, nothing part. And it was between Henry and Mickey Dolenz. And Henry was totally against everything envisioned by Gary. And he convinced them, and you know, I own a house today because of Henry Winkler. Thank God he got it. But he created this Fonzie character, and he created it 100%. That part was not written. He created every nuance of that character.
Amazing. Yeah, and a lot of people always thought that Happy Days was a spinoff from American Graffiti.
No, you know? It was Love American. We did the pilot for Love American. Not, we did the pilot, they aired it in Love American
Style.
And then, because of the success of Graffiti, And by the way, George Lucas saw a film on Ron with the original Happy Days pilot.
Oh.
Yeah, that was way before graffiti.
Wow.
Yeah. So, not many people know that.
No, I don't think anybody knew that.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
So, over the years, you know, I know that at one point, you know, you felt, you know, Potsy this or Potsy that, but
who?
You never really let it bother you because Ron said it.
Oh no, Ron, it's so funny. One time, Ron, it's in the book.
Right.
You know, you're a young guy, you know, and all of a sudden you're hot, but you're hot with a name. They know who you are, they know what a character is, right? And you don't know, you go, well, no, that's not me. Well, they don't know that's not you, they know what they see. So I'm bitching to Ron, and Ron says, what the heck do you have to complain about? I got Richie and Opie. He says, Anson? He says, what? We have to earn our names. We have to do things where people know who we are. Right now, they don't, and I went, oh my God. And that like put me right, I went, you're so right. So it was a great life lesson. I go, okay, use this for a bigger purpose. And I would say today, all of us on that show deserve our own names. Because everybody has like accomplished much more than the show. But because of the show, we had the opportunity.
Right. What about some of the other shows you did before Happy Days? Do you have any particular memories of like Marcus Welby or Owen Marshall?
Well, I do. Marcus, let's see. Owen Marshall, oh yeah. My first dramatic role? Mm-hmm. It's interesting because I got the role because of like going left when everyone's going right. I was doing a show in Hollywood, live stage show called Victory Canteen, which eventually became Over Here on Broadway with John Travolta. But they tried it out in Hollywood. It was written by the Sherman Brothers, who did Mary Poppins.
Sure.
And all that. And it starred Patty Andrews from the Andrews Sisters.
Wow.
And it was like Victory Canteen. It was like a 1940s kind of campy show. And I got a replacement job in it, like, and I thought, oh, this is it, Hollywood. I'm gonna be in this. And the cast has been there forever. Said, yeah, right. No one's showing up, but old folks' homes. That's who's showing up. Sure enough, old folks' homes. That's who. And I'm sitting there going, I thought, oh, I get a big agent. No one cared. So I went, okay. You know, the mountain does come to you. Go to the mountain. So I'm looking, I go, well, there's William, way back then, there's William Morris, there was International Famous Agency, and there was CMA, Creative Management Agency. IFA and CMA became ICM today. So IFA was closest. So I went, okay, I'm gonna go there. So I parked like 8 miles down below because I couldn't afford like the parking, you know, whatever. And I said, okay, I'm going to go up there and I'm going to get an agent. Because the cast told me, no way, you can't get an agent. Impossible to get an agent. No way you can get an agent. They don't care. They don't care about stage. I went, well, and I was stupid enough to think that they're wrong. So I went up there and cold call. I went into IFA and it looked like the Taj Mahal, you know. And I went up to this receptionist who was like really like rude. You know, and said, I'd like to see an agent. Oh, who's your appointment with? Anyone's fine. I said, I'm in this great show. They got to come see it because it's really good. And they go, you need an appointment. You need an appointment. You need it. I go, you know, I'll just, you know, great. I have nothing to lose. I go, you know, I'll just sit here until someone's available. So I did a sit down strike in their reception area for hours. I mean, and all of a sudden I'm sitting there and you know, there's like all these weird, there's like a door here, a door going to various areas of this like whatever. And the door, head would pop out, click. Head would pop out, click. And I'm sitting there going. Literally, on my kids' heads, man, hours I'm sitting there. And I thought she threatened to call everything, including a firing squad, to get me the hell out of there. And I sat there. And finally, after hours, I'm sitting there and I hear this, hey! I turn around and there's the door. It's open. Two the kingdom. And this guy comes out in a suit and a tie. He goes, I go, huh? You, come here. Come here. I run up there. He goes, you. I go, wait, are you an agent? He goes, yes. That was all I had to hear. You gotta come to Victory Canteen. Reagan goes, would you shut up? Come with me. Drags me. I'm inside the beast. I go, and it turned out he's like the lowest agent on the totem pole. And we go in this office, which is like less than this, but it was like, again, like I went, it was like, I'm in. And he goes, stop. He said, you know how lucky you are? I go, no. I wanted to say, you know how lucky you are? But I didn't want to say that, because I didn't really know. So he says, I said, we've all heard back here there's this pain in the ass kid who won't leave the lobby. Okay, that must be me. He goes, well, they just handed me this breakdown for a segment of Owen Marshall Counselor Law. I go, I don't need a doctor, I need an agent. He goes, it's a television show, idiot. I go, oh, okay. He goes, they're looking for guest stars of high school football players. We don't have a lot of kids here that are over, people here that are over 18 that look high school. He said, can you act? And you can, I go, oh yeah. Now, I'm a musical, I've been in musicals, drama, who knows? He goes, okay. He says, wait, I got a hunch. I am going to send you out on this call. It's at Universal, blah, blah, tomorrow morning, blah, 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 blah. I don't know what, they will tell you what part when you get there. I'm going to send you out. You audition. If you get the part, we'll sign you. Give me. I'm going, I got a part. Okay, so there I went. I went in cold call, went up the elevator, went in there, did a sit-down strike. I got an audition the next morning. No one else on that, my Victory Canteen got an audition. I go down there, 10 a.m., Universal Studios, the Black Tower. Has anyone seen the Black Tower? Very intimidating when you're a young person. Especially with Lou Wasserman at the top, all that stuff. And I'm going, ooh. And I go up and I go, hey, I'm the blah, 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 I'm this, I'm gonna, oh yeah, here you are. You're playing the part of Steve Baggett. Here's your sides. Sides means what you're gonna audition with. Now, here I am, not a drama lesson in my life. Nightclubs, musical comedy, it's the death scene. I'm playing a high school football receiver who dies on an overdose of drugs in the locker room. It's the death scene. I look at this and I go, oh my God. Right? I'm going, so, and it's in the, actually the story's in the book of what gave me the tools to do this, but there's, so I go in and they go, oh, here's John Epstein, the producer. And there's this, and I didn't even remember the name of the other guy. Guy had glass, kind of quirky looking young guy, going like this. And a casting director who's reading, right? So this quirky guy with glasses and John Epstein. So I'm there, and it's like this plush, it's Black Tower with like, back then it was like this shag carpeting, like this thick. It felt so good dying. honest to God, I went, oh God, this is comfortable. Seriously, it's so hot. I went, oh my God, this is wonderful. So I die good. I felt it. I went, I die good. I get the part. I go down to, I go, the agency signs me. I got an agent, right? I go down there. Who's the director? Well, the director that cast me, Steven Spielberg.
Wow.
Because Steven Spielberg had already done Duel, but he was friends with John Epstein, and a director dropped out, and I guess they broke Mott's or something, and he said, as a favor, he came in and just took over it, and so last thing, it's in his unauthorized autobiography, there's a thing, it was the last thing he ever did to know, ever. And, of course, he didn't hire me again, so it couldn't be that good. But anyway, and that was it. So I died good,
wow,
on camera, and then all of a sudden, I had a career. And guess what? No agent ever came to that, to Victory Canteen. the week after I shot that, they were all in the audience. Major agents that had never been to that show. Because I asked the receptionist, I'd like to see an agent, and then just went with my gut, and I moved forward and didn't listen to other people telling me what I can or can't do. And that works, and by the way, and that works for any profession, anything, not just show business. Don't let society tell you what you can or can't do. Connect with you and know what you can do.
So who is the individual that you reference in the book, and explain how that individual in particular came into your life?
And Willie Turner?
Yes.
Well, it's interesting, the way this whole book came across, because honestly, it says it's a memoir, it's not. It's really a book that's going to help a lot of people. It's really a motivational book. And, you know, it's funny, in my life, you know, I started as a number. I guess we all start as numbers. We're numbers because we're told we're numbers. No one's number. Everyone's an individual. Everyone's important. But you don't know that until you live life a little bit and find out, you know, wait a minute. Don't classify who I am, what I can do, what I can't do. Stop it. But I was like a number at that point. And if it wasn't for an African-American man in his 50s, who wasn't well-educated, who was an alcoholic, who taught me more than any president of the United States could ever teach me, any teacher could ever teach me, any motivational book could ever teach me, I wouldn't be here today without this man, Willie Turner. I was 15 and a half years old, right here in Burbank. It all started here in Burbank, because it was Leonard's department store on Victory Boulevard, which isn't there anymore. It's now, it's right by Lancer's, there's mm-hmm. Lancer's, mm-hmm. There's a building there. It used to be Leonard's department store. And I would eat it, it was actually, I could afford Lancer's back then. But and we didn't have a lot of money. We're, you know, lower middle class family, but back then you could have a house, you could have a life with no money. You know, GI Bill and all that. And, but anything extra you wanted in your life, you had to get a job you had to work for. Period. You want a dog, you better feed it. You want this, you need to earn money. So I was always, so I got a job part-time as assistant janitor at Leonard's department store. And I had a very harsh upbringing. My father, who we came together years later, but he had a harsh upbringing. He was World War II, you know, two Purple Hearts. I mean, all of a sudden married, anger issues like crazy. And I basically was blamed for everything he never had in his life. So I knew everything I wasn't good at. I knew everything I wasn't good at, everything and nothing I was good at. You know, if it wasn't for you, I could do this. If it wasn't for you, I could do this. You know, so it was a really great, you know, self-worth situation. So if there's something wrong in like Africa at that time, it was my fault. I mean, yeah. So I get to Leonard's department store. I get a job as assistant janitor. My boss was Willie Turner, head janitor. And I described him, you know, he's African-American, middle 50s, you know. He drank because honestly, his upbringing was so horrendous, it kept him neutral. You know, I mean, unbelievable, he could function. And not well-educated, but a prophet. The most understanding individual of human nature and potential anyone I've ever met, ever to this day, ever. And he called the janitorial room was this very small little room with janitorial supplies, and he put two oil drum cans in there. That was our seats, that's where you sat. And he called it the talk room. He didn't have great command of the English language, he would call it the talk room. And I'll never forget the first day, I'm working, and at the end of the day he goes, boy. He goes, yeah, I need to talk to you. I go, oh, here, I'm done. Okay, I'm waiting for like, it's over, it's done, you're fired. Of course, I'm like, my dad, you're done, you're horrible. We sat down on those old drum cans, he said, you did good, they can work out fine. What? You did good? You know the last time someone said I did good? I don't remember the last time someone I did good. Anyway, that was the start of a relationship. And in that talk room, I got so many life lessons every day that affected me so much. By the time I was done with that job, I knew who I was, I had the confidence to be who I was, and I had the guts and the confidence to move forward because of Willie Turner. And what happened was, years and years later, I get a call from Reader's Digest. Because I had all these Forrest Gump stories. I mean, literally, this number in the world, excuse me, you were kidnapped by the President of the United States' daughter in the White House. Yeah, I was. I was kidnapped by the President of the United States' daughter in the White House. Yes, I was. And brought up, yeah. You met Elvis Presley in a parking lot? Yeah, I did. You spent a day with John Lennon? Yeah, I did. Yeah, I did. They go, they said, well, you know, we have this section coming up, and would you mind writing a couple of the stories and kind of what motivated the stories? I go, that would be a challenge. I've written a lot for television. I've written a lot of things. I've directed a lot. I'd never written an article for a magazine. Okay. So, and they wanted kind of an introduction to the stories. I go, okay, so I call this a 2 a.m. book. Because that's about the time I had with 5 daughters at home. Or 4 daughters at home, right, Jessa?
Yeah.
Yeah, one outside that calls all the time. And I'm trying to remind her the word husband. But, you know, that's funny. Anyway, I'm sitting there and I go, okay, what's this introduction? And I hadn't thought about it for a long time. And this feeling came through me. And the first line was, there would be no stories without Willie Turner. And I wrote this introduction. And it just, Willie Turner wrote it through me. I'm telling you, it was like, I just wrote it. And I sent it to this editor at Reader's Digest saying, how's this for the intro? I get a call 2 days later from the publisher. We want a book. This is a book. I go, what? This is a book. Can you write it in 30 days? Because of this and this and this and this for the first draft. Anyway, it turned into paying Willie Turner forward. Because there's stories in this book. You know, I mean, crazy. I mean, being a Rat Packer for a night. I mean, Sammy Davis Jr. giving me my big break. Having his dressing room, having his valet, having his bartender, being like a Rat Packer for an evening, giving my big break in Atlantic City and in Harrah's Arena. I mean, crazy. But none of them would happen with Willie. And each one was directly attached to a lesson he taught me. And I thought, wow, if I could write this book, and if I could put everybody that reads this book in the talk room with me, if everyone could have that time with Willie, if everyone could have that same it factor that motivated me, that inspired me to move forward, I said that would be purposeful. That's, I don't want to write some stupid sitcom guy memoir. Oh, isn't this cute? I want to write something that means something. I'll write something that affects people that 50 years from now, you know, Willie can affect. So the book. So basically, it's in my face is on the cover. That's an excuse for Willie. It's his book. So even even the publisher called me up and said, you know, Anson, reading this book, it's not chapter one, chapter two, it's lesson one and lesson two. And there's 30 lessons in that book, each one going back to that talk room. Great stories. I mean, you know, all the, you know, first film I ever wrote and produced starring Betty Davis, you know, that story, you know. You know, dating Susan Ford, that story, whatever, all these, but the bigger story is going, is that's an excuse to bring you back to the talk room for your life, to motivate you, to so you can climb your mountain. And it's funny, Willie said, one of the biggest things he ever said, he said, you don't look at the mountain, boy, you climb the mountain. That's who wins. How many of you look at the mountain? You keep looking at it. How many start to climb? You know, and you got to fall off to win, by the way. You climb a few mountains, but you got to start climbing. You got to fall. It's not falling, it's winning. Because that gives you the tools to stay on top. That gives you the tools to have the humility and the life experience to stay there. So, anyway, that was the basic motivation for it. And Singing the Bulldog, the reason for the title. Am I talking too much?
No.
Okay.
I was just going to ask you, what's with the title?
Well, it was interesting because one of the lessons was Singing the Bulldog. Because it's funny, way back when I was working at Leonard's, one of our jobs was unpacking the appliances for the appliance department, and there were these new refrigerators. And way back, older than you, trust me. Back then, no. So we're unpacking these refrigerators, and the big deal was, which is like, makes me feel like ancient, the big deal was the freezer compartment in the refrigerator didn't freeze up. No ice. It kept your food frozen without ice, right? And I go, hey, Willie, they should put up a sign. Freeze your food, not your freezer. He goes, that's good, boy. I go, what do you mean? He goes, that's powerful. You go, what? He saw my entrepreneurial abilities before I did. As far as the it factor of how to sell something, and that goes into directing, that goes into selling products, whatever. There's an it factor of how to do it that connects with people. And he goes, that's powerful. Use that right, that's powerful. And I kind of sort of knew, I didn't know, I'm 15, what do I know? 2 days later, there's a banner across the entire appliance section. Freeze your food, not your freezer. He talked to the manager. They sold out of refrigerators. Do you know what that made me feel like? Like my dad, you have no, you're, all of a sudden, I created something from nothing. I'm like getting kudos, and that started. I went, oh, okay, finding opportunity, So, go 2 years late. Years later, we're on Happy Days. Show starts, and back then we weren't paid the salaries of today. Today we'd be getting $60 million a week for what we were. I mean, what, 60 million people a week? Look what Friends got it, like 23 million people a week, right? So basically, back then, and I'll be true, back then, even it was good, but you wouldn't give it, it was $900 a week, $1,200 a week second year, $1,800 a week third year, which is good back then. You weren't gonna get rich, but it wasn't like, oh my God. So I'm looking at, but Willie always taught me, find the opportunity. So instead of bitching about what I didn't have, I'm going, what do I have, what can I do? And I saw Partridge Family just went off the air, David Cassidy singing. And I kind of talked to him, and I found out how much he made more off the show. Brady Bunch, it was the last year of the Brady Bunch, they started singing.
Right.
And I go, what? What do you mean? What? What are you doing? What? I went, okay, I used to sing in nightclubs. I was in musicals. What if I can convince Gary Marshall to put a band on the show? What if I could sing on the, show, I probably could get booked singing. In my head, I'm going, this could be really good. You know, I'm being entrepreneurial. Freeze your food, not your freezer, right? So one morning, early morning, I had a break. I find Gary, who's very busy, and he told me he was busy. It's Gary. He goes, I go, it only take a minute. He goes, yeah, you only got a minute. You know, everyone know how Gary Marshall talks? You only got a minute. Walk with me. What? Walk with me. I had 60 seconds to change my life. So I did the elevator pitch. I said, Gary, you got girls on the show. You got cars on the show. It's the 50s. You don't got music on the show. We need a band at Arnold's. He goes, I sing. You sing? Yeah. Are you good? Yeah, I'm good. Oh, a band. I go, yeah. I go, stop. Wait. He goes, stop.
Hey, Bill, bookseller, chief customer service, please.
And go.
Really didn't move you forward. So anyway, and he goes, wait. He goes, I used to be a drummer. Yeah. He goes, and I can see his mind going, like I connected with something. He goes, there's a show coming up. It's not at Arnold's, but it's a fraternity. Yeah. He said, we can play the band. Yeah. I like this. Yeah. Yeah. You go to Bobby. You go pick a song. We're gonna put it in. This will work good. I go, great. I changed my life. Thank you, Willie. 60 seconds. I'm singing on a national television show. This is it. And then I hear from a distance, but you're singing to a bulldog. I go, excuse me? He goes, you're singing to a bulldog. He goes, well, no. He goes,
you know, I pretty much, you know, believe that you're a good singer, but I don't have time to hear you. So, but what? He goes, you're singing to a bulldog. If you get it, if you're good, I get laughs. If you're bad, I get laughs. You're singing to a bulldog, and he walks away. So if you look at the first time I sung on Happy Days, I'm singing, I'm all shook up to a bulldog at a frat party. You're singing to a bulldog, and I sang to a bulldog. But you know something? That moment, and the reason I put this in, you know, Jump the Shark came out of Happy Days.
Yeah.
And actually, it was kind of wrong because they thought the shark episode was jump. It was the beginning. Jump the Shark means the moment success starts to decline. But actually, it went on for 5 more years, so it wasn't quite that fast. But to me, I went, well, singing to bulldog is the moment you start to climb. Because singing to that bulldog became much more than singing to a bulldog. It created music for the show. It got me a contract with the same record company as David Cassidy. I was getting $900-some a week. For the show, I was getting $17,000 to do a concert off the show. Okay? Off the show. Nothing to do with the show. That's climbing your mountain. That's beginning to climb. That's finding what's right, not what's wrong. That's finding opportunity where people aren't looking for opportunity. And that's Willie Turner. And that was that same moment of freeze your food, not your freezer. Right. Same instincts. Find opportunity, find the moment, find what you have, not what you don't have. So singing to Bulldog, it's a motivational line for everybody and everybody's mountain.
How did you then make the switch from acting to directing? When did you decide you wanted to direct?
Well, being entrepreneurial, I started producing first. On the show, I started optioning properties and this and that, and creating things and trying to sell and finding my way. And I got things in development. Finally, one day I talked to Ron, and I told him about this idea for Skyward, which came out of a real moment, Burbank again. I was driving past the Burbank airport. I forgot, but on kind of an offshoot street, mm-hmm. and there was this old plane, and there was this guy, and there was someone in a wheelchair. By the lights were on the plane, and it looks like they were kind of working on this plane. And it hit me, and I went, "Geez," and I started thinking about, you know, judgmental kind of situations. So if someone's in a wheelchair, you're always making him look up. You're always reminding them they're in a wheelchair. You're never letting them forget their disability. I thought, what if for the first time someone in a wheelchair can look down? What if they could fly? What if they get out of that chair and fly and look down? Wouldn't that be kind of an incredible image and commentary on judging anything? So I created a story called Skyward. And I explained it to Ron. He went, "That's fantastic. I love that." So we went to NBC together and we sold it into development as a movie of the week. And we got the script. It was really good. And they said, "Well, you know, it's such a soft film and it's not, then we got the film. They said, "We want to pick it up." And then we said, "But we want a disabled actress to play the part." I said, "It'd be very hypocritical if we can't cast someone that can act that's disabled. It would be very hypocritical not to have that opportunity." "Well, we want Melissa Sue Anderson from Little House on the Prairie." So anyway, Ron and I ourselves went out. We found Susie Gilstrap. And Ron played the part of Coop. Ron, and I actually directed him. And we shot a test with this unknown actress who happened to be disabled. And Brandon Tartikoff, God bless him at the time, we went in and we said, "We want Susie." He looked at me and went, "I understand you guys. I do." He says, "There's business here." He goes, "Wait." He goes, "You get someone like Bette Davis to play the crusty female stunt pilot in her 60s or something, and we'll go with it." Well, back then, getting Bette Davis to do a movie of the week was like getting Moses to return from the mountain.
It's like, you know, okay, let's get Angelina Jolie to do a movie of the week. I mean, it's like, yeah, right. And we're sitting there going, well, we're dead. That's it. We don't want to do the movie, really, if we can't do it right. Yeah. That night, I'm watching the Carson show, Tony, and there's Bette Davis. And she goes, I am so tired of people giving me old lady parts. I'm so tired of this. I want to do something with action. I want to do something that I want. I went. I call Ryan. He goes, send it. We just literally cold send it to our agent. Unbeknownst to us, that Bette Davis, who hates everybody, including her agent, doesn't trust anybody, reads everything, sent. Don't you judge for me. We get a yes. We go back, you'll see it, Skyward, starring Bette Davis. And it was, Ron directed it, I exec produced it, and it was the film that gave Ron the credibility to get the okay for Night Shift Splash and blah, 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 right?
So what year was that?
That was 1980. So after that, I started getting into the, you know, producing, and I really didn't like it that much, because it was, you know, when you get in the producer thing, once it goes to film, you're kind of like, hello, hi. There's like not a lot of emotion there. It's like you're just kind of hanging around. And I told Ron, I said, and he says, you know, you should direct. I go, great, a third career. Mm-hmm. He goes, no. So, I had observed John Schlesinger directing, Day of the Locust. Spent it. I saw all the musical numbers of Grease that was started at Paramount. I saw all the backlot stuff of Chinatown. I mean, I had some really good mentors as a director, and Ron. So I had, but the guts to do it, right? So we had a project in development called No Greater Gift, after school special, and Ron said, "Well, first of all, I went in and I'm executive producing it, and I co-created it." And even then, the network was like, I don't know. So I finally convinced them to let me hire myself. But Ron had to back me. Now, here, Ron had already done a night shift, by the way. So you have this feature director saying, I will come in and take over if he fails, which is a great friend. And they said yes. So my first directing job was No Greater Gift, where I hired myself. It was about organ donorship and all this. Anyway, we also won the Humanities Award on it. But it ended up being terrific, and then the next one was Lone Star Kid, which I co-wrote the script.
It was also an after school special.
No, it was for WonderWorks, starring James Earl Jones. And basically it was about the youngest mayor in the history of the United States, 12 years old. And it was actually a microcosm for Washington, of the way government should work for the people. And I won't get into all the details of the story, but this 12-year-old kid did more for this town because from his heart. And I thought, wow, will anyone ever get the real reason for this film? And we got great reviews and all this, but quite a few years later, I got a call from PBS and a letter. When Poland, way back then, was becoming a democracy, which my grandmother escaped before World War I, the Constitutional Committee requested a screening of Lone Star Kid. They felt it was like a prime example of a republic and pure democracy. And they screened it before they put their constitution together. And I said, oh my God, someone got the bigger picture of this. And then my career went downhill from there. But that came out of that. But anyway, that was the beginning of directing. And after that, I started getting hired, and you know, it became a career, you know, now since, you know, I've been able to do over 300 shows. But it all came about from, again, Willie Turner. It was about, you know, just moving forward, finding the way. And
I'm sure that you're inspiring many people here tonight.
I hope so. I hope I'm inspiring all of you.
I think with your book, you're becoming the Willie Turner for many.
Well, that's it. It's moving it forward. Because I don't care how old you are. It stops society. You know, this culture, our culture, tries to define us. Stop it. All the living matter on Earth, combined with all the living matter in our galaxy, sun, moon, whatever, is less than 4% of the Creator's universe. However you want to define that, whatever, just remember, it's not big enough for a pole. And you're letting our little culture define what you can do, can't do, when you're retiring, what your 401k is. It's all made up crap. You know, we all have to live within it, but get your heart past it and start moving forward. I don't care what, there is no age. There's nothing stopping you but yourself. And one of the greatest lessons of Willie, don't get in the way of yourself, boy. Do not get in the way of yourself. And let me tell you, you know, every day the media, they're constantly motivating us to do that. Stop it. Really, just blank it out.
And you know, you're very health oriented too, and in the last couple of years more so. Do you want to talk a little bit about that, about how your exercise regime and all of that?
Well, I don't know. Have I improved, Jessa?
Well, you look the same, first of all.
I know,
you look great.
Well, I'm 20 pounds less. Yeah. Well, okay, tomorrow I'm 66 years old. Which is nothing. But honestly, I got more going on now than whatever. In business, huge stuff. I mean, and it's all from not getting in the way of myself. You know, I have these feelings. I move forward. I don't question it. Oh, but I'm 66. Oh, but I'm 6. Oh, but I'm this. Oh, but I'm not. What? Because that's what the ads tell you? Mm-hmm. The ads are marketing. And believe me, they'll change on whatever sells. I am in marketing. I've had a product business for 17 years. You know, I was on QVC for 10 years. We've got a whole new, I am the example for what's going on QVC in January. You know, so what I'm saying is don't let society put stuff in your mind of can't or limitations, because you are what you think you are.
That's right.
You are what you think you are. And honestly, with health and all that, you know, you are what you think much more than what you eat. Okay? Number one, because even if you eat wrong, I saw my dad, even my father-in-law, they could have lived healthier lives longer if they ate right, but their minds kept them going. Their thoughts, their mind kept them going. Could you imagine what you can do if you're also like somewhat disciplined in your health regimentation? So with me, it's portion control, and it's there was a book I read years ago which was incredibly helpful. It's called Your Body's Many Cries for Water. Might want to write that down. You can get it for like $6 on Amazon. Yeah, Your Body's Many Cries for Water. You're not sick, you're thirsty. It proved how many diseases are caused by dehydration.
Oh yes, absolutely.
Okay, and coffee doesn't do it, and tea doesn't do it, water. And the other thing is, everyone says, don't do salt, you need salt, but you need unprocessed salt. You need, because we are sea salt. Our brain, our spine, we're all in salt water. But processed salt will kill you. Now, if they say, oh, drink 8 glasses of water, well, you can actually drink yourself to death with water. You know, dying of thirst, give them water, they will die. Because you're depleting more of their chemistry. So the basic rule of that book is half your body weight in ounces of water a day. If you're 100 pounds, 50 ounces of water. 120 pounds, 60 ounces of water. 1/16 of a teaspoon of sea salt per 8 ounces of water. Could be on your food, could be on your tongue. It's not a lot, but
What kind of water, though? Distilled water?
Water. Your sink water's fine.
Really?
You bet. Your sink water's fine. As long as it's, a decent city, and your pipes aren't fungi. But yeah, so you don't have to go up. And 1/16 could be on your food, could be on your tongue. If you're doing, 60 ounces of water a day, how many per 8 into 60 is what? Whatever, 1/16 of a teaspoon per 8 ounces. It's not much. And that keeps your body chemistry in check, and your immune system, and you will, I'm telling you, a lot of asthma, goodbye. Most asthma is dehydration.
All life comes from the water, that's the point.
No, I'm saying, but I follow that, and I follow portion control. And I say, yeah.
Well, you're doing the right thing,
yeah.
Clearly, right?
So anyway. And also, in our book, and it's funny, our book, we have a huge thing coming out on QVC in January. It's called Perfect Portion Cookbook. 100 calorie count cookbook. And what we did is we got 150 of your favorite comfort foods. key lime pie, you know, turkey pot pie, whatever. I mean, 150 made that made him a little healthier, right? Exactly how to get 100 calorie portions, exactly. So say I have a 1700 calorie diet, right? Eat what you love and never overeat. So, and we're the first to do it. I mean, it's like down to a gnat's butt. You know, I want 300 calories of chicken pot pie. I want 100, we have like perfect little cheesecakes, 100 calories each. 10 chocolate covered pretzels, 100 calories. Right, but not bad. So I'm saying it, so eat what you love and never overeat. Perfect portion control, how easy is that? I'm looking at like Weight Watchers, I hate the food, and I can't understand the count. But everyone understands 100 calorie, because it's part of your, it's just part of the social fabric. We figured it out. And then you'll go to a website, 100caloriedinners.com, 100caloriedlunches.com, they'll have all these great recipes in perfect 100 calorie portions. Do I want 100? Do I want 200? Do I want 300? All right? All of a sudden, QVC is saying, oh my God, it's a, and let me tell you something about finding that. I knew nothing, a year and a half ago, I knew nothing about food. Nothing. Zero. But my wife Jackie says, oh, get some of this 100 calorie popcorns at the Ralph's. And I'm down there, and I go, oh wow, look at all these. 100 calorie, boy, that's a business. 100 calorie, everything's 100, look at all this stuff, portions. And I'm going, oh, okay. So then I'm thinking entrepreneurially, I'm going, 100 calorie. I look at Amazon.com. I can't get to the end of these 100 calorie things. Thousands of them. Everything. Crackers, cookies, blah, 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 all these snack pack, whatever. And I'm going, geez. And I'm thinking entrepreneurially, I wonder if there's any place where you can get all of it in one place. Like, if people want it, is there a place you can go to get whatever you want? Just ignorantly? There isn't. I go, God, oh, someone's got to own 100caloriesstore.com. I mean, 100 calories, I mean, it's got to be like, it's like Kleenex.com, you know? Available. I go, that's weird. I just went and got all these 100 calorie packs of popcorn. 100caloriepopcorn.com, available. Dinner's available, lunch available, breakfast, you name it, is all available. Nabisco, all the big guys, all the so-called gurus, society tells you the important people, yeah, they didn't buy up the real estate with all their MAs, PhDs, whatever they are. Stupid, not street smart. They all know only what they know and what to tell you. I bought it all up, all of it. The only one I didn't own was snack. Everyone else, dinners, lunches, Breakfast, dinners, you know, 100 calorie Christmas, Thanksgiving, freaking soups, 100 calorie desserts. I'm going, God, can we do 100 calorie toilet paper? I don't. But I'm excited because I'm going, I know what it means. I know what it means to have something that's like part of the societal fabric, this goal. And I didn't even know what to, I didn't even know what to do with it. And really, no idea what to do with it. All I know is it's just an instinct's pushing you. Buy it all up and park it. And they go, 100 calorie diets, 100 calorie workout, 100 calorie. I'm going, someone's going to want it sometime. And they're going to have to come to me. And I went, okay, so I parked it. I just went with the feelings. I didn't listen to anybody saying, oh, that's stupid. I just went with my gut, which you have to do. So I park it. And I'm going, this is great. Amy, my business part's going, that's great, wonderful. What do we do with it? I don't know. I just something's going to happen. Let's just move forward. Let's just keep climbing. Let's just move forward. Something's going to happen. I got a feeling, man. And then Willie, in the book, go with your feelings. Go with your feelings, boy. And going with your feelings, connecting to who you are. It's not feelings that are true to who you are. You just go, and I'm telling you, we're no different than a little lion being born in Africa. They immediately know where to go and what to do. There's a tie-in to the creator, however you want to call it, there is a place for us. There is a place for us. You know, you will, that feeling will get you to a place. It's a destiny. So, I'm I'm going to finish here. Okay. So anyway, I don't. Okay, it's late. I don't care.
No, I was going to. No.
So anyway, no. This is getting good. So no. So anyway, I'm at QVC. Okay, QVC, right? And I'm there doing and I'm there, and what we want to do, we were on for 10 years with this other thing, and I'm trying to start something new. I'm at QVC. I get the word no, sorry, thanks. Oh God. So I'm going. I had to pay for the ticket, and then there's this. I see this man across, called Robert Warden. Now, I knew him but didn't know him. I was in the beauty area with all these products for years. He's in food. The guru of food, 22 million cookbooks sold, Cook's Essentials. You'll know him. He's like huge. So, I go, oh Robert, I remember. Oh yeah, hi. And I said, Robert, by the way, I bought up all these domains. It's food, you know what I mean? He looks at me and goes, oh my God. We're looking for this portion control. Oh, really? Anyway, ABC, why did I buy up? Now, we sold Perfect Portion Control to QVC. Big, huge send-off in January. All right? We partnered up with Robert. Oh, I said, oh, Robert, by the way, I own all these other domains. How about this? How about everyone comes back to this website, 100 Calorie Chef. They come, the cookbook's there, then they go, oh, and how about we now compete with allrecipes.com, tasteofhome.com? How about we have 100caloriedinners.com, lunches.com, soups.com, desserts.com, and everyone, and they click, and there's all these great, wonderful recipes people love in 100 calorie portions. That all these corporations now, they're not going to come for one ad, they're going to come for 30 ads. Because they're going to put their ad for lunches here, dinners here, breakfast here, drinks. He goes, oh my God. And I found out what my gut feeling was all about. And it all came together. So right now, this instant, we now have a place for everything. At 66 years old, okay? So don't you ever second guess any of your desires, any of your feelings, any of this. Don't anyone say you can't. You can.
Let's open up the floor to some questions here. Yes.
Anson, you're doing a lot of this sort of motivational stuff. Have you ever done the circuits on the motivational speaking tours or that kind of thing?
Yeah, actually, Don Most and I, who's one of my best friends.
Yeah, we saw him sing not long ago.
Isn't he fantastic?
Awesome. Yeah.
Is he not like, where did you see him?
At Vitello's.
Oh, yeah.
Because
you've got up a couple times in the shows, right?
I just did it with him in Dallas, too, yeah. To me, Donnie, I'm so proud of him.
So passionate about it, and so shy about it at the same time.
He is so brilliant.
He is.
But anyway, we together actually do, we use Happy Days, we do a motivational talk together around the country. We do these lectures. And now we're putting together a show, Happy Days Live.
Awesome.
And we're gonna be it's gonna be you'll be seeing it, yeah. Okay. So we'll be So in fact, we got another talk October 5th in Michigan, and we just got back from Dallas, and we do that a lot. We love it.
Personally, yeah. I'm sure everybody here, and I've gone to a lot of big motivational shows with Tony Robbins and God rest his soul, Dr. Wayne Dyer. And I think that what you're coming across on just a small scale is so passionate and so powerful.
Well, thank you. Thank you. But that's really, I mean, it's actually paying forward
here's the thing, you know, because of classic television, this is happening.
Yeah, it is true. No, actually, you know? You know what's funny about classic television? And I think, because I've directed so much since then. I've directed a lot of unclassic television. Non-classic television. Trust me. There's something about classic television. Even when we did Happy Days, there's a simplicity to the process. I mean, even when we did Happy Days, there were like three Mitchell cameras, which are like Lucy cameras. Same operators as I Love Lucy on our show.
Wow.
with the Mitchell cameras and the ones that began three camera.
Right.
Anyway, it was such a tactile experience then. You know, it was just not a lot of tech go on and all this. And there was something so simple and so tactile about it that I think came across on the film. And that's all of it. I mean, Andy Griffith or you know, I Love Lucy or Happy Days or Laverne and Shirley or what all those. There's a reason for it. There is something, there's an it factor that happens because of the process.
And Jerry Parrish, who directed many of Happy Days, obviously
yes.
started out on the Dick Van Dyke Show as the next door neighbor.
He was the director of Dick Van Dyke Show, and they made him he convinced him to cast him as a neighbor.
No. You're right.
He was a neighbor, convinced him to direct. I know. Just testing you out. But how's that for a mentor?
Yeah, that's amazing that you had. And he died so young.
Yeah, 60, brain cancer,
yeah,
brain tumor.
That was sad.
But you know, but Jerry, it's so funny with Happy Days. By the after like a few years, people come on the set to think we're nuts because he could direct by grunts.
Yeah.
No, we'd go there. Okay, and stand there, start there. Come in. All right, let's go. Come in. I go. Oh. Mm-mm. Yeah. Okay. Go back to it. Yeah. You never. There wouldn't be the direction. Would be through like grunts, but you knew that's not funny. It's the wrong. You didn't have to say anything. You just knew. We were that connected.
And isn't it true that he was the one who said, "Why don't we put it in front of a live audience?"
He was the one. He was the one that convinced Gary Marshall. Yeah.
Because the first what. First season, second season was...
First and second season were one camera, and we almost were canceled. We're in 48th place. And we're almost canceled. Fred Silverman came over as head of ABC and saw some light at the end of the tunnel. And we were like working like hell to try to bring up the ratings enough to get picked up. And he's the one that said he wanted Henry up front. So it was a combination of Henry up front, change it to three camera, Ron Howard saying... It's who had the power said that's better for the show. Let's do it, and so all those combinations put us into a three-camera situation, and we became number one show in the world. The third season, we became the most successful show in the history of television. The third season, we had an average of 58 million people a week
Amazing.
Watching that show,
Amazing.
Up to 67 million a week while it's in syndication. I mean that's you know.
Huge.
It was like a phenomenon, but I think you're right. But the people felt what we just it was like a whole movie. They were seeing what we felt personally.
Right, which takes us back. Right.
Yeah.
More questions.
Yo.
How do we keep this going? The classic TV. That's the most.
MeTV. MeTV is the new cable network that's bringing it all back. Support MeTV. That's exactly what it's doing.
Well, there's Antenna, there's the New Decades, there's Cozy TV, so there's a lot of them now. And people today, you know, the young kids obviously are discovering them, and they're, you know, good is good, you know. I mean, if something's good, whether it was made in 1975 or today, people are recognizing that.
My favorite show still is The Honeymooners on Kinescope. Without rehearsal, look what they
right,
did.
Right.
Are you kidding? I mean, that shows you that's comedy.
Right.
Oh, mine? Yeah.
Oh, well, thank you for asking. if you want, by the way, you know, these programs are put on by the Classic TV Preservation Society, so I am open to donations this evening. It helps a great deal, so be as generous as you can when we're going to be signing our books over here. You can go to classictv.blogspot.com, or you can email me at classictvps@gmail.com. Thank you for asking.
I have another question for you. Yeah. Would you ever do a show similar to Happy Days, kind of like throwback?
Or a reunion, you mean? Would
no,
that ever be possible?
Because they're starting to do, I read today that they're doing the A-Team again or something like that. But would you bring a show back similar, like a facsimile to Happy Days?
I could, you know, it wouldn't work. It's like, I know when we did Happy Days, everyone thought, well, we'll do a 50 show and if that'll work, and everyone failed. You can't replace the magic. You can't replace that it factor. You gotta go with what you, like 100 calorie. You just go with which, whether it's in show business, you just If I had a feeling for it, yes. If there was something that that you really couldn't define, but like push you, yes. I wouldn't try to copy anything.
No, not copy it, but kind of a modern.
But and isn't Gary doing a Laverne and Shirley movie? He's working on it, a Laverne and Shirley thing.
I think so. We'll see. That's not my interest. My to me, it's like classic because it's classic. There's something there that you can't duplicate. There's something bigger than the whole above the page. Do you know that? And that's very, very difficult to
recapture.
Even with Star Trek, even though they made Star Trek like these hit new movies and all, it's almost like a different venue than the original Star Trek. Mm-hmm. Do you know? There's something that was not matched. Mm-hmm. Those initial relationships have never been matched.
Never. What we always wanted as Trek fans was to have the original show back on TV, and that never happened.
Right.
We got everything else.
Yeah.
But we never got those characters played by those actors.
Exactly. So what they did, we'll do Star Trek. So they made a new, you know, wonderful, really well done new, but it's a new show.
Right.
You know, it's like, oh, that's cool. It's not, the new kids liking it aren't really that into, you know, William Shatner, or you know, maybe after they go back and find it, mm-hmm. but it's like it's a well done new invention to me.
Yeah.
With lifelong theme, with Gene Roddenberry's lifelong themes.
Yes. Yes.
I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, yes, to some extent. Yes, Elaine.
Do you want to act still, or do you miss acting? What's your real passion?
not so much acting. My real passion is like moving forward. My real passion is creating something new every day. My real passion is to like just to go with my feelings and to make something happen in every area of life. Better life for our family, you know, a new product, a new show, whatever. I mean, I just don't define it. I feel it and I move forward. Yeah.
You've got to, I'm sure you're feeling that being typecast as Potsy, you've got to be really proud of that show. There were like, what, 3 spinoffs that came from Happy?
Yeah, at least. Well, 3 that made it.
You were in, I believe, every single episode.
Almost.
And, you know, I don't know. I just had a brain fart here.
Oh, God, I haven't. Come to my side. How many have I had on the way over here, Jesse?
Well,
you lost count. Well, thanks.
You and Ralph Mouth, you know, you had
Donnie.
Yeah, you guys had small roles in the first couple of seasons, and then you guys just really blossomed. I mean, the Fonz, he had.
Thank God for the Fonz. He bought my house.
Well,
so are you jealous of Fonzie? No. You keep going. Hey, I'll hang on.
But he was—he had a very small role, and then all of a sudden he became like the big star.
Right, he was. Yeah, it was the breakout.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he said that even Ron set the stage.
But Ron set the stage. Ron could have said no. He right. said absolutely.
But see, you created you brought in the singing.
Yeah.
Henry brought in
right.
the coolness.
Yeah.
And. Yeah, I mean, it all just...
It was collaborative, but that...
You know,
that
I would think you would not mind being typecast as possible. You've got to be very, very proud of that.
Oh, I am proud of it. I never felt typecast or anything, because my goal was never to be a movie star. My goal was to get behind the camera. So to me, it was like an amazing opportunity. So the only thing is you just got to get used to, because, you know, the public knows you by what they see. So some know Potsy, and you just have to understand that. You know, you can't let ego get in front of
the bigger picture. Well, you utilize it for in a different way.
I did. We all did. Yeah. We all utilize it in very positive ways. You know, and we're still working. We're still moving forward. So I have nothing but appreciation for it.
Well, you played the part very well.
Thanks.
You became part of the Cunningham family.
Yeah. It was, I mean, it was
Chuck
amazing.
Chuck moves out, you move in.
Chuck. What happened to Chuck?
Two Chucks.
Oh, two Chucks, yeah.
There were two Chucks. Actually, there was a Chuck. And then they went, Chuck's not working, so we'll get another Chuck. Then 1 week there was another Chuck, same part. That wasn't working, so 1 week there was no Chuck.
He was Chuck.
Hi, Chuck. We'll call you sometime. No, what it was, they found out they didn't have enough room for the character. It wasn't the actors, it was they just didn't have room for the characters. So one day, he was away and they had a couple of phone calls and then no more Chuck. I don't know, did anyone see the, about 6 years ago, we did a reunion kind of show. Did you see it?
Yeah.
It was a big hit on ABC. They had both Chucks on. They're my boo. Yeah. Looked up, I went, you're Chuck?
Any other questions? Okay. Oh, Brett, yes.
I'm here.
How are you?
Nice.
Now, yes, there's a connection, right?
Oh, well, I was one of the ABC pages that worked on your show.
Oh, hi! Thanks for the tickets. Well, you had to get, no, you had to be nice with the pages, because I mean, there are like 8 billion people out there, and you really had to be nice to the pages to get your friend in. It's true. Remember that?
Oh, yes.
Remember those lines?
Yeah.
Crazy.
Going all the way down to Astro Burger and around the corner.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And people trying to get in with for like 3 extra tickets. It was because there was a very small, it was maybe, what, a few hundred people?
Not even.
Not even?
But they were on bleachers.
Yeah, on bleachers.
On stage there.
Yeah, I mean, there wasn't a lot. I mean, here's the number one show in the world in a few seats. But we didn't know. He's going, oh, good. Yeah.
Well, my question was going to be, you as an actor, was there a different dynamic from the early seasons when there was no audience to when we did bring in an audience?
Oh, a totally different show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. In fact, I my part was changed dramatically. I used to kind of be the instigator, you know, kind of the Jerry Hauser role in Summer of 42. Hmm. Hey, come on, let's go. And then I became more the naive kind of ooh guy.
Yeah.
But once because they had to kind of redefine the relationships. So it became much more of a funny.
Well,
comedic show
was
in front of
too.
Yeah, and much broader.
Yeah,
you know, much more comedic because it was a sitcom. We went from kind of a
half-hour
drama, kind of a graffiti-ish, mm-hmm. little more humorous, graffiti-ish, but still kind of, you know, one-camera show, to a full-out sitcom. So and I know Henry was very nervous because everything was exaggerated. And his whole part was under, you know, was like under. So he was very nervous how that would come out. And, you know, he didn't have to be.
Anymore.
It wasn't until he got to the live audience that he started wearing the leather jacket.
Well,
no,
the leather jacket.
He wore it in the second season.
Oh,
so
he did?
Yeah, okay. But the leather, well, no, he, no.
Yeah.
He wore it the second, no. He wore it, no. He wore it when he was on the bicycle. He didn't wear it without the motorcycle.
Okay.
Because here's what happened. During the third season we were on, they were still complaining about, you know, Gary wanted him to wear the leather jacket. And ABC was saying, no, that's a hood. Shows how different things are. No, oh, that's bad. Bad image for the kids, wearing a leather jacket. Whoa, really? So.
And it's because of him that everybody got library cards, right?
Right, like, right. But what happened was, so Gary convinced the network, listen, it's for safety. If he's with his motorcycle, you wear a leather jacket because, you know, in case you fall. He said, if he's with his motorcycle, he can wear the jacket. That motorcycle was in Arnold's. It was in Mr. C's kitchen. It was in his room. Oh, no, look at the episodes. And then finally they said, okay, all right. But it was hysterical. It was brilliant. And yeah, one episode was Fonzie getting a library card. And library cards took the power of that show in a week, doubled in the United States of America. Library cards. That was the power of the show.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes?
Well, when did that, because the leather jackets, Barbarino wore one too.
Yeah, but that was
the year, like, from yours to.
It was later in the 70s, he was.
Cotter came on later.
75.
Yeah, Cotter came on later than us.
76, 77.
Yeah. I don't know.
So when, but that they were complaining about it, because John Travolta wore it on Cotter.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
well, 74,
was 74,
75. It was like between 75 and 76 is when it turned into a full leather jacket, yeah.
Yeah, because
we probably helped Barbarino.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But can you imagine back then that was a big deal?
Yeah.
Is that hysterical?
Are you still in touch with everyone?
Yeah, we are. Yeah, Don. I mean, Ron, Henry, all the time. Ron. You know, Ron just finished Inferno with Tom Hanks, the Dan Brown. Just got back from Budapest. But he's back east most. Well, now he's all over the place again. But yeah, he's like a brother. And Don is like my best friend. He lives 20 minutes away. I live in Malibu. He lives in Westlake. And Marion Ross is in Woodland Hills. We see her all the time. And, yeah.
What about Erin?
Erin is in Indiana. I saw her like about a month and a half ago. We did an event, and she's looking great now. She lives in Indianapolis with her husband. Indiana. Not Indianapolis. Indiana's in some town I forgot. But she's good. She's doing good. And Scott Baio's doing great.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I got a quick one.
Oh, yeah. Well, I tell you what. Whatever your other questions are, you can come right over and talk to him personally.
I'm getting, yes, we got to do this. I can see. They're closing Barnes Noble.
All right. Thank you so much. That's a huge hand for Anson Williams.